Well, hi, everyone, and greetings from Northern Michigan. This is Bob, the Science Guy. You know, I had an interesting experience today at the office. I had a patient come in, and I happened to notice that he came from Lansing, which is quite a ways from where my office was today. And if he came from Lansing, he had obviously passed half a dozen doctors that do what I do. So I asked him, "Why did you come up to see me?" And he leaned a little closer to me and said, "Because I'm a fan of the secret YouTube channel you have." And he gave me this thing that he made for me. So I want to dedicate this show to Brian. Thank you very much for coming up and showing your appreciation. That really meant a lot to me today. It actually made my day. Now, today we're going to go ahead and finish our interview with Dr. Pinizzotto. Now, Sleeping Warrior had misused a demonstration on YouTube that Dr. Pinizzotto had done when he was with Wentworth Technical Institute concerning buoyancy and density and why submarines come up and down. So I'm going to go ahead and play a little clip from that and show Sleeping Warrior's comments on it, and then we'll come back.
But what we also believe in is industry collaborative interdisciplinary learning. Okay, so the interdisciplinary part is that we needed to know some engineering, we needed to do the experiment, we needed to talk to our physics guys, and we needed to talk to the math people about how do we calculate the volume of the ball. How does industry come into this? Let's say you're one of our students and you go and you get a job at General Dynamics Boat Works in Connecticut. What do? They make submarines. You want submarines to both float and to sink. You know now that you have to design a submarine so it's less dense than water. But you also know you want that submarine to go underwater. Great, you know that that submarine has to be denser than the water. So now as an engineer, you know you have to develop a system that will make that submarine at your command be either less dense than water or more dense than the water. It's a perfect application to bring industry, direct industry collaboration into this funny little experiment, which started with a simple question, why does a bowling ball float?
Now, I think based on the first two episodes of this interview, it's very apparent that Sleeping Warrior is misapplying principles to this video that Dr. Pinizzotto made. And Dr. Pinizzotto's not very pleased about it. So without further ado, let's cue up the music and go see what Dr. Pinizzotto has to say about all this. If you would, please go ahead and go down there and click on the captions now so that you can clearly see what Dr. Pinizzotto is talking about. Now, you've taken an opportunity to actually look at the video that was made based on your video. Do you have any comments that you would like to make to the viewers of that video to make sure that they understand your position relative to that video?
Sure. Well, first of all, I think it was taken out of context and I wasn't contacted about it. And I think both of those things are a major problem. And thirdly, not scientific. You would never use somebody's work without citing it. Science, and actually, even in journalism, so I was actually kind of aggravated that they took some parts of my presentation out of context with even without even talking to me. That's the first thing. The second thing is, you know, there are lots of different ways that we could have to that particular demonstration. One way would have been for me to give everybody in the audience equations or put the equations up on screen or do all that kind of stuff, ask everybody that wasn't the point. I mean, that was not a good way to do this. So using the term density, assume that the people in the audience would know that there were forces at play. The people I was talking to were potentially coming there to be an engineer or to be a scientist or to be a designer. To be an architect. Assumption that I could make, and I think it was a very safe assumption, would be that they had had some physics background. And so they would know that for those bowling balls to be there had to be an equilibrium of forces. Otherwise, they would have been rolling off the table and rolling through the auditorium doing something else. And so, you know, taking the word density out of context like this, which was talking about the density of the bowling balls relative to their volume. It's not even the density of the material they're made out of. It was the density overall. You know, we could talk about the density of a ship in a couple of different ways. The overall density of a ship has to be such that it will float. That means its density has got to be less than the density less than the volume it displaces has to be less than its weight or it will float. I mean, and so that's just something to keep in mind.
Yeah, there's a couple of misconceptions about why things fall, for example. And if you could just address those, I'd like to finish up with that. Now, it's been said that the reason that things fall to the ground, you know, like you pick up a rock and drop it and it falls back down to the ground. It's been said that the reason it falls is that you pick it up, put energy into it, and it wants to return to where it came from. Is that why objects fall, or are outside forces involved?
No, that's not why. Outside force is the force we're talking about, which is force due to gravity. So let's think about this for a minute. Let's suppose that I took my 16-pound bowling ball outside, and I took an equally round piece of styrofoam so that it would have the same volume, but they are completely drastically different weights. If I drop them and we didn't have any air, they would hit it from the same height. They would hit the ground together, even though one had an overall much, much higher density than the other, right?
Yeah.
Bowling ball is 16 pounds. My styrofoam, if it's only this big around, probably only weighed an ounce, less than. If I drop them outside in the air, a styrofoam ball, I can fly around. So, doing that experiment, physical. But if there was no air, we put them in a vacuum chamber and drop them, they would drop at the same rate. It's because gravity is the force between any two objects. And it turns out that the force is proportional to their mass and the distance. And when you work it out, the mass of the Earth is so massive that they fall down and they accelerate at the same rate and hit the ground at the same time.
So if you were to take those three bowling balls that you floated in the fish tank and you were to roll them off the roof of the building at exactly the same time, because they are relatively heavy, which means mass times gravity, that's weight. Yep. Because they were relatively heavy compared to their surface area and the cross section that had to cut through the wind, they would all land at roughly the same instant, wouldn't they? Even though they had different weights?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I think Galileo did that.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, he did. I think off the Tower of Pisa, didn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, about 1610 or so, somewhere in the early 1600s anyway, and showed that large weight and a small weight hit the ground at the same time from the top of the Tower of Pisa.
Yep.
Yeah, you can do that experiment.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, you can do that experiment. It's not that tough to do. You know, going back one last time to Einstein and Newton, even though Einstein is a more accurate description of something called gravity than Newton was, Einstein didn't supersede Newton and invalidate everything in Newtonian gravity, because we can still use Newtonian physics to build bridges, right?
Right. Now, here's a principle that I personally had a difficult time with when I first went to college. I think a lot of people still have the same problem. In science, we sometimes will do things that are very, very good approximations within whatever we can measure that aren't necessarily absolutely super accurate to the very, very last Plymouth decimal place. Okay? And that's what's going on here, is that with Newton's laws and we apply Newtonian dynamics to systems that are not moving very fast, and stay more or less in the same gravitational field, it all works out fine. That the difference between that and Einsteinian type of view of gravity, as we said before, is totally negligible. Don't have to get involved with tensor calculus when we're building static structures on the Earth.
Yeah. And as I recall, one of the problems that Einstein addressed early on was the precession of the orbit of Mercury, I believe is the correct term.
Yeah.
And Newtonian physics made an error in that prediction of that orbit of the planet Mercury around the sun that was on the order of a couple of arc seconds per century. So as long as you weren't worried about those last one or two arc seconds of precession over a century, Newtonian physics predicted the orbit of Mercury. Einstein just cleaned up those last couple little arc seconds. So
that's one way to look at it. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I mean, so basically you're looking at the ultimate fine details. You know, you just describe it a little better. Does it matter really if you describe pi to 5 decimal places or 100? And then once you get to 100, what's the difference in accuracy between 100 and 150 decimal places? But there is a difference.
There is a difference, but for all the calculations that we need to do, we don't have to worry about it.
Okay, well, thank you very much for stopping by today and taking a few minutes with us. Hopefully, we'll get to chat again another time and preferably avoid a couple of technical issues that we had earlier. But do you have any parting words for the viewers?
No, I just I guess it's our parting words, right? I would ask all the viewers to really take some time to learn about how science works. I think it's really important. It's what our society is based on, and things need to be based on facts. I would encourage them to find out the scientific facts and all of the other facts that they need for.
Well, thank you again. I really appreciate you stopping by. And hope to talk to you again sometime in the future. Take care. Well, guys, thank you very much for stopping by. This is not the first time that I have called out the Flat Earth community on misusing scientific citations, but it was very nice to actually get the source person of the citation that they misused and get some comments from them. And as a side benefit, we got a lot of other good information from Dr. Pinizzotto, who's a master educator, and demonstrated that in these three interviews. So, hopefully we're going to do a few more of these. I have a couple of people and some phone calls out right now. So maybe we'll have some more of these interviews coming up if you like them. In the meantime, this is Bob the Science Guy signing out from Northern Michigan. Make sure you hit that like, subscribe, and the little bell icon over there. I'd really appreciate having you on Team Bob. Take care, guys.